It's the middle one.
Run in his jerk, the P-51, Sywell base. I talked about it before, that dual control P-51 which you can fly in with Warbird flights.co.uk. So look to the right hand side with your cameras ready. Here comes Mark Levy in P-51 Jersey jerk.
Wasn't it? He's not doing 250 knots there.
That was probably around 300 as he dived in from the east, getting as much. Trying to smash on as he could. Chat, freaking chat. We don't talk about Max Chat, James. What do you think they're talking about?
Max Chat.
You ever heard the term Max Chat?
I never have.
When we talk about full power Max Chat, see if we had air temperature. That's where that term comes from.
Huh. Well, what do you know? And it's great to see so many people still here, isn't it?
It is fantastic. Thank you, everybody. Mark's had a busy day. He actually opened the programme this morning, flying this very P-51 on the wing of the with the F-35, or on the wing of the P-47 with the F-35.
He's coming down.
He'd been part of the Eagle Squadrons. The Eagle Squadrons were all shifted over into the 8th Air Force in 1942. And when they started, they were flying Spitfires, then Thunderbolts, and finally Mustangs.
P-51, that's what he wanted, and that's what he wanted for his fighter group. And lobbied and lobbied and lobbied.
And actually the first fighter group to be equipped with Mustangs in the US Air Force was the 354th, who originally earmarked for the Knife Air Force, which was going to be the tactical air force, the ground support air force. But Blakesley went and lobbied and said, I can turn this around in 24 hours, I can have our pilots ready. And Jimmy Doolittle, who was the commander of the 8th Air Force by the beginning of 1944, rather doubted that, but conceded the point. And they switched over, literally in 24 hours.
And Don Blakesley, the one never regretted it, he left his aircraft with his love for him went very deep indeed. And I can kind of see why. It's an amazing shape, an amazing design. It's small and light, like a little angry wasp. And it has this incredible range. 35,000 feet, can fly over 455 miles an hour. It's faster than anything. It was 70 miles an hour faster than anything the Germans had above 28,000 feet. That's something.
In comparison to a Messerschmitt and a Spitfire, it's actually an ergonomic wonder. If you look at the boxy shape of those bouchons on the line there, and even the very cramped cockpit of the Hurricane and Spitfire, the P-51 was like sitting in an armchair. It's just got so much room in the cockpit, everything seems to be in the right place. Where you look, everything, all the instruments are in the right place. So an ergonomic wonder in comparison to some of those early Second World War single-seat fighters.
Yeah, his fuel efficiency is second to none, which is why it made such a good long range fighter. But it's something like Gallant. Auxiliary tanks. In fact, actually, there's an example of those auxiliary tanks in the museum here at Sywell, which is really brilliant if anyone ever gets a chance to go and look at it. And they've got one, they're made of cardboard. And you just drop them on unsuspecting Germans, I suppose. So it meant they could fire all the way to Warsaw and back if they needed to.
Whistling noise, which is the air flowing over the gun ports. So imagine blowing over the top of a beer bottle and you get that whistling noise. Same effect when you hear that Mustang scream. And another pub fact for you, some of the R2-D2 sound effects in Star Wars were actually the Mustang scream.
I didn't know that. Well, the things I've learned from you today, Lingy, it's amazing. But the four fighter group, I'm picking out them, but I could have picked out the 56th or 354 for any number of them. But I think the key point about them is that they fulfil the three M's: method, motivation, and morale. They had a great plane, they knew what they were doing, motivation was good, they understood the mission, morale was extremely high because they were all incredibly good at what they did. And Don Blakely, as a fighter commander, was just superb. Tough, no-nonsense, hard-drinking, square-jawed, good-looking, and kind of fostered a really strong sense of high morale, self-confidence, but not complacency. There was no question that these guys knew that flying fighter planes was a hard job. Difficult job, dangerous job, but there was confidence in their ability and a desire to constantly get better. And in the P-51, they had a plane that enabled them to do all that. Wide undercarriage, easier to land than a lot, robust, highly maneuverable, fast, and incredible endurance.
Was there ever a plan to get it navalised?
I don't think so. You know, the naval planes were doing very nicely, thank you, without having to convert non-naval planes. And this is an absolutely lovely display, isn't it? Really pulling up those places. I know for a fact he's having a lot of fun up there. Beautiful evening. Amazing airplane to be able to control his own.
The sky to himself.
How could you not? You know, and I just can't stress enough, but by the sort of second half of 1943, you've got the bomber crews absolutely struggling, being decimated. Odds stacked against you getting through your 25 missions in a bomber. The contrast with the fighter groups could not have been greater. Where they had good planes, even before the people to one plane, had nothing wrong with the people who suddenly saw earlier on. And then you had prep and training. And of course, as you know, the sales, you can train very quickly, which means you can process more people. The intensity of training is better, so it's not spread out. No problems with bad weather or anything like that. You know, down in Florida and Texas and so on. Plenty of sunshine all year round in which you can fly and learn to fly. Build up your hours, get over to Britain. 350 hours in the logbook. You know, that's a decent amount. Then make the transition from trainee pilot to combat worthy fighter pilot, and there's a difference. Because it's a bit like driving a car. After a while you don't think about switching the indicator or slipping it into what gear or whatever. You just do it. It's sort of muscle memory. It's on automatic. And really, as a fighter pilot, that's the situation you want to be with flying the plane. You don't have to think about flying the plane. You just want to do it, which means you can then concentrate on the difficult role of actually being a fighter pilot, a combat pilot. And I cannot stress enough the importance that the P-51 played in achieving that. Its ability to escort heavy bombers far and deep into the Reich so that they could hammer those Luftwaffe aircraft factories in Regensburg, in Wiener Neustadt, in Austria, made all the difference.
Well, a thoroughly graceful, enjoyable display from Mark Levy. Please, ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together. Mark Levy in P-51 Jersey Jerk. Beautiful conditions. Great display. And now we're going to move on to something slightly slower. But what is a very special moment for this gentleman? To the right-hand side, taxiing out in that mauve Tiger Moth Golf Alpha Mike Tango Victor, is a heritage scholarship, which I'll talk more about very shortly. But you mustn't underestimate what this means to Danny for his first public display. The route to becoming a display pilot is not an easy one. You need to have a lot of experience, and then you'd have to be assessed by what's called a DAE, a Display Approval Evaluator. And that is a pilot with display experience who can be a mentor and assessor of your performance, and then recommend to the Civil Aviation Authority that you are fit to be a display pilot. And then if they're happy, they will award you that permission to display. And that's what he gained this week. So it starts at very slow stages, small stages. So you might not have the approval to do any complex aeroplane.